With another season in the books, it's time for the second annual Thinking Basketball Top 10. These are based on a season's worth of film breakdowns, all those links are in the description box below, and a mountain of data and theory that hopefully helps you think about your top 10 list differently. For me, best is how much a player helps a team win a championship, so lifting really poor teams to average heights is mostly useless. My approach instead focuses on skills that scale up or maintain value alongside better and better teammates, so I really value skills like shooting, passing, and defense. This list is also less about the list and more about player strengths and weaknesses and how valuable these skills are in different settings. It's really hard to perfectly pinpoint a player's value, so I'll emphasize ranges. In other words, if I hold all the other players on the list constant, how much higher or lower could I see a player based on his uncertainties? Health also matters to me, but we'll account for that at the end. Let's start by assuming all players are at full health for the season and the playoffs. Based on that, who gives a random team the best chance to win a title? The 10th spot could go to a number of players this year. Before the playoffs, I assume this would be Paul George's spot, but he struggled enough on both ends of the court to drop him back. There are a number of similar candidates as well, but if forced to pick, I'll go with Jimmy Butler. I've never been too high on Butler, mainly because his scoring game doesn't excite me too much. Jimmy's a solid but not spectacular isolationist, coming in around 22 points per 75 on above average efficiency. But it's been everything else this season that's jumped out to me. Good passing, smart cutting, excellent decision making, and then attacking mismatches as needed in the Miami offense we examined last week. Butler also draws fouls at an elite rate, and despite his low-volume three-point shooting, this kind of profile fits very well on good offensive teams. Last year, the 76ers had a 113 offensive rating with him on the court alongside Embiid, and in this season, that number was 115 and almost 118 in 700 playoff minutes. He's also a big, strong, versatile defender who adds solid value on that end, and that combination is enough for impact metrics to view him as a fringe top 10 player. At number 9 is Damian Lillard, who put on a shooting exhibition this season by extending his range to the logo, which kicked his scoring up a notch. As noted in his profile, Lillard's run once the calendar turned over made him arguably the most effective scorer in the league at that point, and his solid playmaking means he's one of the best on-ball offensive weapons in basketball. Dame's in a group of 6 offensive studs in the game right now, we'll get to the rest shortly, but he loses ground to many of them with his subpar defense. He does have some off-ball gravity, but more of his value is playing on the ball and attacking drop coverage in the pick and roll, which means he wouldn't clash with other on-ball talent per se, but I don't think he'd really amplify other perimeter stars either. His one-number metrics are similar to Butler's, although PIPM views him as a dreadful defender. I can't really go that far. He's a vulnerability on that end, but certainly not a disaster. And these numbers agree that he's one of the best offensive weapons in the NBA, and his deadly shooting is even enough to make me think he could land at 8th on this list, ahead of Joel Embiid. Embiid lands here for the second straight season, and like last year, he's still a monster scorer in the post. His scoring rate was actually ahead of Lillard's this year, only on slightly lower true shooting. But a lingering question with Philly's big man is whether he can create enough offense out of the post to make playing through him worthwhile. He had his way against a smaller Celtic team, 32 points per 75 on plus 4% relative true shooting, but Boston absorbed that scoring because he wasn't able to create shots for teammates like Lillard or any other high-end offensive engine. As I discussed on episode 64 of the Thinking Basketball podcast, I do think there's a middle ground here where an Embiid-led offense with the right shooters could be good enough to win in the postseason. Philly's posted a 113 offensive rating in the last 2 years with Embiid on the court in the playoffs, and he has a plus 9 net rating in about 500 minutes despite never reaching the conference finals. I actually think the bigger issue here is whether his defensive value is elite in the playoffs. Conditioning issues aside, Embiid's fifth in defensive PIPM in the last two postseasons, similar to his regular season rank in that metric. I think an engaged Joel can wreak havoc on most opponents with the right defensive teammates, but drop coverage centers who don't extend to the three-point line and pick and roll seem like they're bleeding value in the playoffs these days. Rudy Gobert would have normally been 10th for me, but as the league gets smaller and more spaced out, I'm concerned drop coverage rim protectors are prone to bad matchups over a long playoff run. In defensive PIPM, Gobert goes from 2nd in the regular season over the last 2 years to just below average, and Brook Lopez and Miles Turner also decline in value in the playoffs too. Embiid still looks good in this stat, and these are small samples with plenty of noise, but they create enough uncertainty that I wonder if Joel has that legit MVP gear in the playoffs that could take him as high as, say, 5th on this list, or if he's merely an all-NBA player who would slot just below Lillard. At number 7 is Nikola Jokic. Jokic is also a bit tricky to pin down because he's still an emerging talent carving out a unique role as a big man driving high-end offense. As noted in his profile last season, Jokic functions more like a 7-foot guard, world-class passing and playmaking, and scoring from 3 different levels. In 1,200 playoff minutes over the last 2 seasons, the Nuggets have a sparkling 116 offensive rating against decent defensive competition, and Nikola's numbers go up across the board in the second season, making him look like an elite perimeter engine. Using 3-year filters that are slightly lower than Jokic's current output, these are the only players to score with similar volume and efficiency and create a ton of offense for teammates. Barring a disastrous postseason, Jokic will join these heavyweights next year, and given how well his passing and outside shooting fit next to other perimeter players, I think he's one of the best offensive centerpieces in the sport right now. The question is whether his three-point percentages are sustainable in the playoffs. He's made 42% of his 154 attempts and looked like Dirk Nowitzki at times in the bubble. And more importantly, I also wonder how to construct a defensive roster around his shortcomings. I'm concerned about his value on that end when he runs into teams with spread pick and roll operators who can drill pull-up threes, and it's hard to build championship-level lineups while occupying the center position with a neutral defender. Impact metrics also have him as a top 10 player in the regular season, but it's a bit dicier in the playoffs, where his defensive numbers have dragged him down a bit. Future seasons will help shed light on this, so for now I could argue that he's behind Embiid, and maybe even Lillard, but my more generous evaluation would have him 6th, ahead of newcomer Luka Doncic. Luka's another offensive superstar with questionable defense, but he's harder to place right now because we only saw a handful of games in the bubble, after another 4 months off to work on his craft, and it's possible he's jumped up yet another level. Luka's shot creation estimates this season are some of the highest on record. He and Trae Young were the only players this year to possess the ball for at least 50% of the time when their teams were on offense, and this Luka ball produced a whopping 119 offensive rating with him captaining the ship. His incredible passing skills, mastery of spread pick and roll, and crafty scoring make him feel like a more versatile version of James Harden. Luka's expanding how he uses his large body and unique athleticism to dominate smaller perimeter players in the paint, shooting 73% at the rim this year, the best rate in the league among non-big men. And while his outside shot is still inconsistent, he made just 32% of his threes, Luka finished 3rd in the league in scoring rate this season on respectable efficiency. One number metrics think he's right in this top 5 range, but remember, Dallas's system is built around him, so his fit with other high-end talent isn't captured well in these numbers. Given his age and his questionable defense, I could see him anywhere from 8th to 5th right now, with further growth to come in the future. Speaking of Harden, there's a good argument that this was actually his best season. He carried over that floater that he worked on last year, and that helped him produce his best scoring postseason in Houston. The Rockets actually outscored their opponents by 3 points per 100 with him on the court in the playoffs. I broke down the opposing defensive schemes in both of his matchups for Patreon subscribers, where the Beard not only scored well but moved the ball to open teammates as needed. Those videos also illustrate some of his key weaknesses. For instance, he only shot 63% at the rim because he's not a great vertical finisher in traffic, and he can't comfortably shoot over smaller defenders in close. And that allows opponents to chip away at his enormous regular season value in the postseason. Impact metrics view him as basically a top three player, maintaining that value in his short playoff stint, but the same caveats apply here that did to Luka. Harden's a ball-dominant machine with a system built around him, and those numbers don't quite capture his defensive limitations, nor his inability to provide value without the ball. Despite strong post defense and a wiser approach on that end, I have a really hard time seeing him as anything more than neutral on D, and that's not quite enough to crack the inner circle for me in 2020. The first of those four inner circlers is Kawhi Leonard, maybe. As we examined earlier this year, Kawhi's playmaking clearly improved this season, and that, along with some healthier defense, make this a clear upgrade from last year. So to me, this is a great reminder about judging players based on singular circumstances or matchups. The Clippers were a flawed roster, especially on defense, and Kawhi's defensive strengths were fairly ineffective against a movement-heavy Jokic attack. Remember, last year in Toronto, he filled a perfect scoring need on that defensively constructed roster, whereas this year he acted sort of like the lead initiator for the Clippers, and the results look way less impressive. Both are small samples, which is exactly the point. Neither extreme really represents a player's quality. He looked like one of the very best in the game in the major metrics this season, and in the playoffs, those numbers don't dip too far, despite playoff scoring that was well below his standards that we discussed in last year's top 10 video. I could easily have him third this year, and maybe even second on this list, but if forced to choose, he lands at four. And now we've reached the hardest part of this exercise. Giannis Antetokounmpo. Giannis is a monster on defense, and his physical domination makes him a handful as a scorer. He actually led the league in scoring rate this season, dropping 33 points per 75 possessions, which is one of the highest marks ever on strong efficiency. But my concern is that an offense built largely around Giannis isn't that effective in the playoffs. It's a small sample, but in the last two postseasons, Milwaukee has an uninspiring 107 offensive rating with him on the court after the first round. And in those 500 or so minutes, Giannis's offensive PIPM falls outside the top 10. Now, this is certainly not gospel, but these kinds of signals have me wondering if there's a ceiling on the Bucks' five-out attack without some army of elite shooters. And at that point, it's maybe best to play a more dynamic style anyway. To be clear, Giannis Ball still might be good enough to win a championship, it's just not nearly as potent as the regular season numbers suggest. I've compared Antetokounmpo to Shaq before. He's dominant around the basket, but struggles outside the paint and at the line. But I wonder if David Robinson is a better historical comparison here. He's largely the pillar of everything Milwaukee does, and we might be looking at overachievement in the regular season that makes the postseason appear underwhelming. His playoff numbers are still near the very top of the league in the last 2 years, and he's certainly good enough that I can see the argument for him at number one. Remember, LeBron had disappointments in his first three postseasons after winning the MVP, so I still think there's more to discover with Giannis. At number two, I have Anthony Davis. Remember, I laid out Davis's argument for the game's best player in last season's top 10, so the only name he's really leapfrogged for me is Giannis, And again, I'm almost flipping a coin on these two. Like Adetokounmpo, I imagine we'll have more clarity here with a larger sample. But I think Davis's Swiss Army knife defense might allow him to amplify any defensive scheme in the playoffs, kind of the opposite of those drop coverage big men bleeding value. I highlighted these skills in his profile recently, and while I wouldn't necessarily try to build an offense around him to outpace, for instance, Giannis's Bucks, Davis's off-ball value allows him to fit with most other stars in the league while punishing teams who try to go small. This offense-defense versatility might be a lethal combination in today's smaller, stretched-out league. Davis was first in the playoffs in Raptors defensive component, which incorporates tracking data, and the Lakers held opponents about 4 points below their regular season efficiency, which isn't earth-shattering, but considering Lillard, Murray, Jokic, and the entire Heat team looked better on offense in the bubble, I find the Lakers' defensive performance to be more impressive than the numbers suggest. AD is right at the top of the league in one-number metrics in the playoffs, and while I don't think his outside shooting is really this good, he's shot over 50% from the mid-range in the postseason, any permanent improvement to his shot upgrades his isolation game while making his off-ball versatility even more effective. Like last year, I still see an argument for him as the game's best player, although if his defense isn't quite so game-changing in the long run, and his shot completely regresses, he'd fall to fourth on my list. And at number one, that leaves the ageless LeBron James. At nearly 36, LeBron has a great argument as the game's best offensive player. His combination of scoring versatility and playmaking put him a shade above James Harden for me, and LeBron's shift toward a power game and more bully ball has kept his scoring elite. James shot 69% at the rim in the regular season on a high volume of attempts, and that's jumped to 73% in the playoffs. As discussed before the year, he has a great case as the best passer in the game too, and the Lakers' 118 offensive rating in the postseason continues a long tradition of James-led teams skewering defenses in the playoffs. In last year's top 10, I wondered about playoff LeBron. Well, here's what the rest of that graph looks like this year. Once again, he's first in the postseason in my box plus minus model and in PIPM, and a key driver to all of this has been his defense. He's been a big positive on that end, with his off-ball rotations and reads augmented with rim protection and switchable on-ball defense when needed. I do wonder how much the shutdown before the bubble helped recharge his batteries, or if his circumstances helped him avoid long, grueling matchups. Either way, I can't really go much lower than third as a reasonable floor for him, and even though these top players are all really close, LeBron is the one with the strongest argument for number one in my eyes. Health doesn't affect things on this year's list too much. Otherwise, that wraps up another top 10 list. I'm always interested to know what changes for you after watching something like this. Remember, there are a ton of links with video breakdowns in the description box below. And if you want a deeper explanation on concepts like shot creation, scaling to better teams, or overreacting to specific playoff results, check out Thinking Basketball, the book. A big thanks, by the way, to Crumple Jumper for creating the player art in this video, and to Patreon subscribers who help make this a reality. Sign up at patreon.com/thinkingbasketball to access those subscriber-only videos I referenced. Hope you enjoyed this wild and crazy and long 2020 season, and that wherever you're watching in the world, that you are having a great day.